start with the next part of our NAMS notes. The causes of hemolytic anemia, right? We are dealing with causes of hemolytic anemia. So let's discuss the first point. Let me read what's present in our notes. It's present that the causes of hemolytic anemia, first cause intrinsic or intracorpuscular, right? That means the defect is present in the RBCs. That means the defect lies in the RBCs, right? And you have got extracorpuscular defect. That means the defect is lying outside the RBCs. So we call it as extra, outside, corpuscular, RBC, right? Extra corpuscular defects. And intracorpuscular defects are defect lies in RBCs, right? It may lie in the membrane, it may lie in the hemoglobin, it may lie in the enzymes. So now let's start with the first point from our notes, the membrane defects, right? Membrane defects. But understand, it's something like you have not yet watched Bahubali and you started speaking about Bahubali, right? The same thing represent to our intrinsic corpuscular also. Like if you don't know the membrane of RBCs, how it looks, then it's waste of studying the causes under the membrane. So let me teach you the membrane of RBCs, then let's make simpler to understand. So this is, right, this is RBC. If I take the section of RBC membrane, right, and draw it here, it looks like this. So RBC membrane has three layers. One is outer glycocalyx, this is glycocalyx, and you have got middle lipid layer, and inside you have got membrane skeleton layer, right? If there is any defect, right, if there is any defect in this, either in the glycoprotein, either in the lipid layer, either in the membrane skeleton, that means which is responsible for the maintenance, which is responsible for the formation of cell membrane, that is RBC membrane, it leads to hemolytic anemia, right? Under this defect, under the membrane defect, so let me speak about each thing in brief, because we have a further sessions where I'll be teaching you in detail regarding these. So first you have got an hereditary spherocytosis. Sphere is round. So instead of by concave, the RBC is round sphere shaped. Right? RBC is round shaped, sphere shaped. And next we have hereditary elliptocytosis. What do you mean by ellipto? Ellipto is oval. It is oval shaped. Right? This all because of this elliptico, then elliptos, then spherocytes. It's all because of this defect in the membrane. Right? You got the next. Hereditary poikilocytosis. Right? Hereditary poikilocytosis. Hope you don't understand my handwriting. You can just see it from here. Hereditary poikilocytosis. What is hereditary? Right? You know the hereditary from birth, your parents. Poikilo. It's not poikilo. Poikilo, it is variable. What is cytocytes? Is cell. Right? That means you have a poikilo, means variable. Right? Poikilo means variable. Variable sites means cells. So you got poikilo means it's abnormal shape of RBCs in blood film. And this abnormal shape of RBCs in blood film, there are many variable. So can I call them hereditary poikilo means variable cytosis? Yes. And next we have PNH. So what do you mean by PNH? Right? So let me read what's present in our notes. The first thing what's present in our notes is under the PNH, right, that is paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. Under this, it's written that you have IVH, it is right. That means under this point of paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, you got IVH intravascular hemolysis, right? Next you have more at night, then you have acquired defect in RBC. So let me split the word paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. The paroxysmal means sudden attack. Yes, suddenly happened. It's not from your birth, sudden attack. Nocturnal is at birth. Hemoglobinuria means hemoglobin in urea. So if you understand the word, each word, that is paroxysmal is sudden attack, nocturnal is at birth, hemoglobinuria means hemoglobin in urine. Right? Can I use this paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria and what he has written? Yes, IVH, you know, intravascular hemolysis. Since it is nocturnal, more at night, since it is paroxysmal sudden, yes, that is the reason it is acute, that is acquired defect in RBC membrane. Right? So that's all regarding the examples of membrane defects. So you have got hereditary spirocytosis, hereditary elliptocytosis, you got hereditary poikilocytosis, hereditary stomatocytosis. This all comes under the hereditary spirocytosis. But why hereditary defect, right? But why we are not including this hereditary defect in paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria is, you should know the meaning of paroxysmal. Paroxysmal means sudden attack. If it is sudden attack, how can it be hereditary? Right? So that is the reason it is acquired defect, not hereditary defect. Right? So that's all regarding the examples under the membrane defects. So let us understand. Next, we have got hemoglobin defects. Before going in hemoglobin defects, right, I have given the same. We should know the diagram of hemoglobin. So if I show you the diagram of hemoglobin, you got two globin chains alpha, two globin chains beta, then you have got heme part. Right, hemoglobin, heme part this is, right, this is heme part. So when I draw this heme part here, you have a central iron surrounded by nitrogen, then you have got this structure, it is present in each globin. So one globin has one heme, right, one globin has one heme, this is heme, right, this is globin, what I have shown is globin, right. And now let's study what comes under these hemoglobin defects. So if you see the hemoglobin defects, but being rich fellows, we speak, yeah, hemoglobinopathies, pathies is nothing but disease, pathy, however you speak, but remembering is important. I repeat once again, how you remember is not important, remembering is important. So let's start this point. And next, under these hemoglobinopathies, you got two. One is quantitative defect, and next it is structural qualitative defect. That means, what do you mean by quantitative? Right? Quantitative is how much it is defect. That means how much, whether one globin, two globin, three globins, four globins, how many they are defect. It comes under quantitative. The example of quantitative defect is thalassemia. Right? I told you quantitative, how much? So decreased alpha chain production might be seen. In beta thalassemia, decreased beta chain production is seen. If one of these, that means if it is decreased quantitatively, we call it as quantitative defects. But what happens to qualitative defects? That means when you look at the hemoglobin, it seems to be normal, but there are defects inside. That means it might be a defect, right, inside the formation of this globin chain. But it looks similarly beautiful, as beautiful, but inside there is something wrong. Right? Like example, if see the example, like sickle cell anemia. What happens in sickle cell anemia? Right? What happens in sickle cell anemia? In sickle cell anemia, the mutated hemoglobin, right? The mutated hemoglobin, this hemoglobin has mutated. This hemoglobin, mutated hemoglobin, right? What does it do? Right? It disturbs, that means it destructs the RBCs. How it destructs? This mutated hemoglobin destructs RBCs how? By forming a crescent shape when at low oxygen level. That means when you look at this diagram, it seems to be normal. Yes, it has got 2 alpha, 2 beta, fine, no problem. Right? Once it is mutated, then you get an hemolytic defects. And next we have got HBE diseases, also responsible for these hemoglobinopathies under qualitative. What does HBC disease? It is beta globin hereditary. There is some mutation, there's some problem with beta globin. Right? Then now it's time to remember. How to remember? It's CDE. How will you remember this? So you know this HBC, because after C, D, E. Before C, it's B. So HBC, beta globulin, right? You know the point, C, right? Because you can remember like this. How can you remember? A, B, C, D, E. We have used A for alpha. We have used B for beta, but what is left? C, D, E is left. C, H, B, C, H, B, D, and H, B, E. Now, this H, B, C disease, H, B, D disease, H, B, E disease are responsible for this qualitative or structural defects. Right. Let's finish under the structural defects. Under the qualitative defects, the last disease is unstable hemoglobin disease. Right? What is this unstable hemoglobin disease? The unstable hemoglobin disease is due to the presence of structurally abnormal hemoglobin variant with substitution or deletion of amino acids in the red cells. That means, right? What does it mean? That means it is due to the presence of a structurally abnormal hemoglobin variant. What's happening in this unstable hemoglobin disease? Right? What's happening in unstable hemoglobin disease? In this hemoglobin disease, now, whether it might be substitution or deletion of amino acids in the RBCs, in this hemoglobin. If there is a substitution or deletion of or of amino acid in hemoglobin, what has happened? It precipitates denatured hemoglobin, right? It precipitates denatured hemoglobin. Once it precipitates denatured hemoglobin, and this is called Hens bodies, right? In simple way, due to hemoglobin substitution or deletion of amino acids, the hemoglobin has precipitated here. Due to this precipitation, there is lysis of RBCs. So that's all regarding the HB defects. So till now we spoke, right? We are speaking about the intrinsic corpus, right? Happening within the RBCs. We spoke about membrane defects, about this. Then we spoke about hemoglobin defects. Now it's time to speak about the enzyme defects. The first enzyme here is glucose 6-phosphate deficiency. And this enzyme, glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme, it is used for the conversion of glucose 6-phosphate to 6-phosphogluconolactone. It is a step seen in the HMP pathway. Why does this break? During this conversion of glucose 6-phosphate to 6-phosphogluconolactone, there is conversion of NADP to NADPH plus. Once there is a conversion of NADP plus to NADPH, now this prevents the hemolysis of RBCs. But now what's happening? Because of this glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase, there is no formation of NADPH, which results in hemolysis. Right. And next we have pyruvate kinase deficiency. What is pyruvate kinase deficiency? In the glycolysis, right, glucose 6-phosphate, glucose fructose 6-phosphate, fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, so on. At the end, you have phosphoenolpyruvate. This phosphoenolpyruvate, in the presence of pyruvate kinase, converts into pyruvate. And during this step, ADP is converted into ATP. Right? ADP is converted into ATP. And now there is no ATP right now. So there is no sufficient ATP, so RBC break off. And next enzyme is hexokinase deficiency. What is hexokinase deficiency tells us? Right? What do you mean by hexokinase deficiency? When you see the glycolysis, glucose 6-phosphate, then glucose 1,6-bisphosphate, okay, so on. Now, hexokinase is an enzyme which converts glucose to glucose 6-phosphate. Glucose 6-phosphate took fructose 6-phosphate, fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, then glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, then 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, 3-phosphoglycerate, 2-phosphoglycerate, phosphoenolpyruvate and pyruvate. But now we are speaking, this 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate is converted to 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate. This 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate is responsible for what? For the oxygen to be given to the tissues. Now there is reduced hexokinase, so reduced glucose 6-phosphate, so reduced glucose 3-phosphate, reduced 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, reduced 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate, then do you expect a good amount of 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate? No, there is low 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate in RBCs. So the oxygen upload to the tissue, right? Oxygen upload to the tissue is reduced, right? Once there is no oxygen, right? Now it leads to hemolysis. So I will explain this everything in the further separate sessions. But let's understand this, because our main motto is not to by heart, but remembering is important. Right. So next we have, coming to the next page, but you got some diseases where you have got both quantitative and qualitative also. It can be seen, right? And now it's the time to study about extrinsic, that is extra corpuscular defect. Extra is outside, corpuscular is RBC's problem. So let's understand that. Understand that means it is outside the RBCs. That means it's in somewhere in the plasma. So let's understand first we have got immune hemolytic anemia. Under the immune hemolytic anemia, we got autoimmune hemolytic anemia, alloimmune hemolytic anemia. Hello, auto. Autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Alloimmune hemolytic anemia. What do you mean by autoimmune hemolytic anemia? Right. What do you mean by autoimmune hemolytic anemia? Right. Let's understand it clearly. The antibodies direct against the person's own red blood cells. Right. Own the antibodies direct against the person's own blood cells, they cause them to lyse burst, leading to an insufficient number of oxygen carrying red blood cells in the circulation. That means this is plasma, you got a red blood cells and you have got antibodies. These antibodies of a patient's own antibodies, auto means own, they go and bind these RBCs and they destruct. But in allo, what happens? During the blood transfusion, the antibodies you got through the blood transfusion, it binds to the RBC and then the RBCs are destroyed. Right. Hope you are understanding difference between auto is one's own, allo is from outside. But they both come ultimately and they destroy the RBCs. Right. This is the first example of extrinsic extracorpuscular defect. Let's understand the next example, that is Maha. Maha. My heart is beating. Ha. Maha. Maha. Yes, what is Maha? It is microangiopathic hemolytic anemia. What is microangio? It is a small blood vessels. What is hemolytic? Heme, blood, lytic is breakdown, right? Microangiopathy, right? There's some diseases from problem with small blood vessels. So if these are the small blood vessels, right, if there is any problem with these, so there is a block, right? So that's what, right, ma'am is explaining us. So what is she explaining here is, right, you can see the blood vessels, right? You can see the blood vessels, right? You can these are the small blood vessels. If there is any obstruction at this point, if there is any thrombi, the thrombi are formed in the small blood vessels. Yes, they are formed in small blood vessels. Now, what do they do? The hero comes. Oh, Don comes here. It comes so fast. It strikes at this point. So, RBC strikes against the thrombi. And there is, what happens if it comes so fast and you hit, what happens? You break, right? Your bike breaks or something. Then there is intravascular hemolysis. Right? That is what I was telling. If your bike breaks, right? If your bike breaks, right? It is split into different parts, right? When this splits in the different parts, same as your your bike, the RBC is when it comes so fast and hit thrombi, it breaks. And when it breaks, what do you find? You see a lots of particles of RBCs. So can I call them, this is RBC? After it hits the thrombus, it has broken down and it has broken into pieces. And it seems to be like a helmet. Yes, it seems to be like helmet what we are wearing. So can I tell these are helmet cells? Right? So what is histiocytes? So let's split the word histiocytes. Right? What does this mean actually? It means that cytosis cell. That means the fragmented parts of RBCs are seen. When you see this cell, it has two sharp endings, right? It has two sharp endings and these are two pointed endings. That is what the ma'am was telling us. In the peripheral smear, we got helmet cells and histiocytes, right? What is this? Histo means split, cytes, we have broken, the cells are broken. Now let's see this gate, this thrombi, whether is this thrombi is made up of cement or made up of bricks. That means, I mean to tell that this thrombi is made up of only platelets, right? It is made up of only platelets, or does it made up of platelets and coagulation factor? Yes. Only platelets is seen in HUS. I'll teach you everything in detail, but let's first understand only platelets. That means in HUS and TPP means hemolytic uremic syndrome and thrombocytic purpura, right? Thrombocytic purpura. In this, these blood vessels, the thrombi is made up of only platelets, right? But in DIC, right, it is made up of platelets and coagulation. So coagulation factors means it might be coagulation factor 5, 6, 7 and 10. Right? So you can remember this has P for P. So TTP. Right? You can remember as this is, so you can remember as a brand Hush Puppy, right? Hush Puppy, P for platelet. And TTP is P for platelet. Right? Now what happens? That is what sir was telling about. He's telling us that the causes are HUS TTP DIC. I told Hush Puppy, HUS seen only platelets. TTP, I P for P, platelets. And DIC, dick, penis, for platelets and coagulation. The name itself is telling, you have got C for coagulation also. That is how you have to remember this. And let's, before finishing this session, we have got a small topic here. I spoke about HUS and now it's time to know what is Hush brief, which interesting. Let's know the concept because our main motto is not to by heart. Let's understand the concept. And this HUS, what is that? Hemolytic uremic syndrome is of two types, right? Hemolytic uremic syndrome is of two types, right? Before knowing, understanding what is hemolytic uremic syndrome, let us split the word hemolytic uremic syndrome. What is hemo? Means blood. Lytic is breaking. What is uremia? Urea in blood, seen in acute kidney. So hemolytic uremia syndrome. And these are of two types, right? Not even one. This fucking HUS is of two types. Those are one and two. That is typical. And next is atypical HUS. What do you mean by typical HUS and atypical? Typical, it is caused by E. coli. So how to remember this? When you pronounce the word T, it becomes E. Right? When you pronounce the word T, it becomes E. So E for E. coli. It's 0157 and H7. Right? 0157 and H7. So let's understand the pathogenesis of what's written at this point. This is our beautiful blood vessels. Right? When this E. coli produces a toxin, right? It produces a toxin known as Shiga toxin. When this Shiga toxin act on the blood vessels, it disturbs the blood vessels. When this disturbs the blood, when there's a break in the blood vessel, tunica media, then to clear, that means to cover this, these platelets comes in that area and they block this part. They block the further bleeding into this lumen. And this blocking, right, this platelet blocks it, right? You think it is good, of course, but later what happens is, this platelet forms a meshwork. It forms what? It forms a meshwork. So it forms a meshwork. And now RBCs are on this side, right? And platelet is the mesh inside. Now, the bike, right, like a hero, you are coming so fast, right? It has come, right? Now, RBCs are trapped at this point. The RBCs are trapped in platelet meshwork, decreased flow to the organ kidney at this point has been decreased and leads to the organ failure, right? That's what the notes we are speaking, that's what the ma'am was telling us, produce Shiga-like toxin, they cause endothelial damage. Why it was, I have told, then lead to thrombosis because of platelet aggregation in small vessels. Then I told about this intravascular hemolysis due to these RBCs which are trapped in the meshwork like platelets. They cannot move. So what they do? They break off. So can I buy? Right. This atypical HUS is caused by T for E, E. coli. So let's finish this session with the last topic, it's a typical one, and this is atypical HUS. And now this atypical HUS is due to deficiency of alternate complex pathway, right? Due to the deficiency of alternate complex pathway, alternate complement pathway inhibitors. That means you got two types of complements. One is classical, one more is alternative. And this alternate pathway, if you see this alternate pathway, right, the classical and the alternate pathways, they are, right, you got C3 here, C3 is converted into C3B. This C3B helps in opsonization, helps in phagocytosis, helps in B cell activation, right? Our body is controlled, right? You got some mechanisms in our body which control this alternate complement pathway so that there is no excess of opsonization, cytosis. This factor H and factor H and CD46, right? CD46, this factor H and CD46, they inhibit this pathway, so there is no excess formation of C3B, so there is no excess opsonization, no phagocytosis, no excess B cell activation. But what happens in atypical HUS? What happens in atypical HUS is there is deficiency of factor H and CD46. Now, once there is a deficiency of factor H and CD46, there is excess of C3B. So, you have got an opsonization. You got B cell activation, production of antibodies. Then, antibody acts on RBCs. So, there will be breakdown of it. So, there is no oxygen supply to the organ and there will be damage. Right? And this atypical HUS can be inherited. It can be acquired. So, that's what it's inherited or acquired. So, thank you guys. With this, we end our session now. So, let us meet in the next session. Bye.